Okay, good afternoon and welcome to Writing Winning Educational Grant Proposals. I've done this workshop all over the place because as I mentioned earlier, as an early ed administrator, it's great to have all the ideas and the best people, but it's a challenge to get the funding. How many of you are 501c3 organizations? Wonderful. How many of you are in a church? Okay. Any of you outside of a church or not a part of a church ministry? Okay. Are you still a nonprofit organization though? Wonderful. Wonderful. There are many grants out there. As a matter of fact, Gandhi once said that God has given enough for everyone's need, but not enough for everyone's greed. There's lots of funding. There's lots of money out there. There's no shortage of money. Even in an economic crisis, a period of economic turmoil, there's still going to be funding. One of the primary reasons why is because when we make money in our nation, what happens with the first like 30% of it? It's taxed. So one reason people give away money is to lower their tax liability. So we're going to talk about ways we can kind of get them to give some of that money to us. An overview of our seminar is that we're going to conduct a strategic assessment of the needs of our program. We're going to look at our program's vision, our mission, our values, our goals, our objectives, and just see where we are. We kind of alluded to this in one of the other sessions earlier, but it's so important that we have a clear, concise, compelling vision. And then we're going to identify acceptable requests that are out there, because there are many grants out there that we are not eligible for as faith-based organizations. But we will look at some of the organizations that do offer funding for faith-based organizations. I really want to encourage you to be a program that has a reputation for being above board and honest about the services you provide and being a program of integrity. And what that means is we don't apply for grants that say that we cannot practice our faith or we cannot teach our faith. So we want to make sure that the grants that we apply for are ones that we are actually eligible for. So we're going to learn to write proposals. How many of you have already written a grant proposal before? Okay, how many of you had them awarded? Wonderful, wonderful, great. Well, I'm going to tap into some of your experiences as well. I've written millions of dollars of grants and had millions of dollars awarded over the years. Every year, I block out about 3 weeks out of the year to just write grants for schools. And so one of the latest grants that I've written is on my website. It was a technology media lab grant where we wrote a grant for a cart, a charging cart with iPads and the Promethean board projector, the salary for the media specialist teacher, because it's great to have all that equipment, but if you don't have someone that knows how to operate it, and then about $4,000 for training the entire staff on how to use their equipment. And so I do write those grants periodically, and I think it's essential that this be a part of your skill set. Okay? So we're going to look at some grant applications that identify the necessary paperwork. We're also going to learn the importance of maintaining a budget and developing that integrity, as I was alluding to earlier. And what that basically means when I talk about your budget is when you get funding for a particular item, spending it on that item. Not borrowing from Peter to pay Paul or whatever, you know, making sure that we are fiscally responsible. We also are going to talk about obtaining resources to assist in planning and the ongoing evaluation of projects that you may want to do in your program. And look at some of the vocabulary that's necessary to include in a successful proposal. Why write grants? This is on page one of your handout. One, because we want to increase the resources that our program has, and also to increase the supports. It's wonderful when you can provide additional salary supplementation for your teachers or additional support staff because you have the funding. One of the schools in Georgia, Providence Christian Academy, which is an accredited ACSI school, wrote a grant for an endowment because they were losing all of their certified teachers to the public school system, because their salaries were not competitive. And with this endowment, one grant, I think it was about $300,000, they're able to each year supplement salary so that they are competitive with the county school system. That is a great initiative to have. And so why? Why do we write grants? Because we want to improve our services. We want to enhance our capability to provide high quality early learning experiences for our children. And we also want to do it in a way that honors our faith. It keeps our faith first, foremost, right? What does it cost you to write a grant? Just time, okay? So today's investment of just a few hours, you will leave here today able to write grants that will be awarded. This investment of time and just learning how to do it is so valuable. There are grants available from the government. They're available from professional organizations and associations, nonprofit organizations, local individuals, as well as global organizations and individuals. There are grants that are available through even your school system, which is one of the government organizations. What are some of the common conditions that they require? One, a grant is never repaid. The golden rule does apply, that he who has the goal makes the rules. So whoever's giving you the money, they make the rules. They make the stipulations. There is usually going to be a proposal required, even if someone verbally agrees to underwrite some initiative that your school has. You're going to have to identify goals and objectives of your program and make sure they match the grant makers' goals and objectives. There will be dates like deadlines and eligibility factors. Typically, some grants, like I did some research here, and it looks like in California you have a community foundation as well. And in Georgia, our community foundation requires you to have matching grants from other organizations. So for instance, they'll say, I'll give you $4,000 or $50,000 for curriculum, but you have to have someone else guarantee to give you the same amount or a portion of that. And then most grant applications are going to require accountability. They will want you to report what you did with the funds, which makes sense. So for just a moment, I'd like for you just to talk about with the people at your table, your dream. What's something you would do if you had unlimited funding at your program? From the top of your head, just share with each other for just a moment. And for those that are watching, why don't you just jot down an initiative that you would like to start, or a dream that you have, a vision you have for your program. Maybe it is toys for your classroom or materials for the classroom, or it's teacher salary supplementation or bonuses, a new gymnasium, playground equipment. Okay, ladies, share with me, what are some of the initiatives from this table? What's one that you shared?
Salary supplementation.
From the table back here. Playground. Anything specifically about the playground? Structures. A structure for the playground. What about your table? What's one? Salary supplementation as well. What about this table? Arts and crafts material. Oh, artificial grass. Oh, wow. I would love that too. Or even just the rubber surfacing that you spray and spread, I love that. What about this table? What's one of the initiatives you'd like to do? A new building. There's money for that. What about this table back here? Salaries. What about this table over here? I'm sorry? Playground covers, awnings for shade. Wonderful. I think you need that out here. Wow, she brought something, shade structures. So what's your playground?
So here's my playground.
Okay, she brought the catalog.
My shade structure.
I love it.
And same thing, I want the
rubber
pour and play surface.
Yes, I love it, the pour and play surface. So she brought her catalog, and that's really what you have to do is start with your dream, your wish list. What about this table over here? Absolutely. Well, first you have to start with a vision. Yes, first you have to start with a vision, ladies. That's where it all starts. But a lot of times, let me get your attention, we have the cart before your horse. as they say. So before thinking about grant funding, you want to make sure you have a knowledge of the needs that are within your community. So often we think about what we want, and is that what they need first? So you definitely need to do a needs assessment so that you can get a broad base of support from not just your families that are in your school, but even from the community at large. There are businesses in your community that will support something that impacts the community and not just your four and no more. And so your mission and resource alignment must be there to address that need that is evident in your community. Look for partners. I love this quote. It says, "One man working with you is worth a dozen men working for you." And that is so true. If you can get the support of your stakeholders, especially in the community at large, they will talk about your program. Word of mouth is still the best form of advertisement. And so it helps if a parent is talking to a board member of an organization that has funding for that playground surfacing, or if a parent is out eating dinner or shopping somewhere and someone sees the uniform with your school name on it and ask about the school, and your parent's able to say, "Our school would like to do XYZ because you've done such a wonderful job in articulating that vision," they're able to kind of catch the vision and run with it. And I've had that happen many a time where we've so indoctrinated our parents with the vision that we've had people call us from places or give us business cards to say, "Call us, we'd like to do a family night for your school and give your school the proceeds to go to this particular initiative you have." So you definitely want to get partners. We're going to talk about five steps. The first step is strategic planning, and it should be there in your handout, where you develop a plan. What do you plan to do? How will you do it? What do you need to accomplish it? Remember, we said we need at least the three M's: men, money, and materials, or people, equipment, and supplies. How will you measure success? How will you obtain resources and ongoing financial support? Often, grant makers are reluctant to give funding to a program that will not be in existence in 5 years or 10 years. So what's your plan for sustainability? Okay? One of the keys to effectively communicating is having a vision and having a mission statement that are, as I keep repeating, the three C's: clear, concise, and compelling. Having a value statement or set of core beliefs outlined is also important. For instance, in faith communities or in the Christian community, we value honesty, integrity, right? We value respect and diversity for others, not in sometimes the way that other people do, but we do. And so those could be some core values that other organizations may also list as their core values, and they can see that they're aligning themselves with a partner that's similar. You also want to effectively communicate your program's objective. And remember, objectives are very broad, and then your goals are very specific, but you want to have those. You also want to talk about the history of your organization. Many of you may be new directors, but it's really important that you go back and research, why was your program founded? What were the credentials and the reasonings behind founding your program? Why did it start? What was the need in the community that it was started to meet? And so you want to look at that and talk about that in your literature, your executive summary. You want to talk about, describe your program. What's the target audience of your program? In order to determine that, you have to do some of that research we talked about in one of the other sessions, where you go look at the census report, you look at the demographics of your community, then you look at the demographics of your school, and see who is your school, whose needs are they meeting in the community? See who else wants to meet that same demographics needs, and try and partner with them. Look at identifying future goals and strategies for your program. For instance, if you're now serving infants through four-year-olds, maybe you need to provide five-year-old programming. One of the reasons this might be necessary is if you do the research, look at your United States Department of Education website or the state website, California, for your district, look and see how many kindergarten students are being retained. That's an indicator that they had a poor preschool experience. That's a need that corporations will give funding to meet. If you say that our program excels in preparing young children academically for kindergarten, but we're going to begin a program to even prepare them for those future grades, because we just learned fourth graders, 70% of them here in California are not performing well in reading, 60% in math. So we want to reduce those numbers, and this is how we plan to do it. We have a research-based curricula that meets those developmental needs of diverse learners. So when we describe our program, we're going to identify how we do that. We're going to talk about that need and the problem we address, just as I did. And then how will we evaluate that? Maybe at the end of the year, having an evaluation instrument or an assessment instrument that's cumulative. It looks at the child from the beginning of the school year to where they are now. Having portfolios. I'm going to talk about that a lot tomorrow in my sessions. How to identify or measure what you're saying that you're providing, because a lot of times, what we offer is intangible. It's really like you can't put a finger on it sometimes, you know? So how do you help parents identify the student outcomes that you are trying to achieve? Being clear about that is so important. Hopefully today we can kind of narrow some of that down. You also want to summarize, and I talked about this in the other session, where are you now? What's our vision? What's the problem in society we hope to resolve? What are the demographics? Where do we want to be? That's our mission and our objectives, that broad overview. How will we get there? What are the specific activities that we will engage in? What resources do we need? We've talked about that several times. You guys could probably say it now, the three M's. And how will you know you're there? Those are the answers you must answer in a grant application. Those are the questions you have to answer in a grant application. So we're going to take a moment and look at some of the legal and financial accountability issues. The first thing you want to do is make sure you have a prioritized wish list and do your research. If your school has mold in it, okay, then the mold is the priority, not a new playground. If your teachers have degrees like mine that's almost as old as your teenager, well, it's older than a teenager, then that's a priority over maybe new playground equipment if the playground equipment you have now is safe. Because otherwise, it's negligent to get the playground equipment, but the teachers don't have credentials, right? Because the teachers are the ones supervising the kids on the playground. Does that make sense? Okay, so that starting out with a prioritized wish list. And so we'll do that. I'll give you time to do that today. Get a wish list together and then say, okay, what are the priorities? And then secondly, having your financial statements and projections, preferably audited, available. So what that means is if you don't have an accountant now, you need to put some systems in place where you have financial reports that are credible. So that may not mean having a bookkeeper do your books every month or hiring someone on staff to do that. It may be using a software program that helps you to track tuition payments as well as payroll and then some of the other expenses, being able to track what you're doing with the money you have already. Because if you can't justify your expenses you have right now, it's highly unlikely someone's going to give you funding. And then if it hasn't been audited by a CPA where they give you the recommendations, you know, I was writing a grant for a preschool that was a Christian preschool, and when I looked at her financial reports, I noticed that her bank service charges were huge. I mean, she had a huge amount each month they paid in fees for either bounced checks from their parents, which resulted in their checks bounced, okay? And I told her, I said, it's highly unlikely we're gonna get this grant for that one problem right there. We've got to put some internal controls in place where parents that are writing you checks that are bouncing, that's not happening. And maybe even get some tuition insurance so that parents that are skipping out on tuition, you're still able to collect. Because otherwise, it doesn't look like a good investment for someone that has grant funding. They're not going to get a real good return on their investment if they're spending $300 a month in bad check fees, okay? So some of those things are like, if you're writing a to-do list while we're talking today, it might be, okay, we need to enroll in Smart Tuition Collection, or what's the other company, Fax? Yeah, so that we only have electronic checks and credit card payments. Fax, F-A-C-T-S, and Smart Tuition, and stop taking paper checks. The wonderful thing about Fax is that they keep running those checks, you know, keep trying to debit it until it comes out. Yeah, and so you're not getting hit with fees on your bank account. Okay, so that may be somewhere where you have to start, all right? If you do have a huge number of students that are not returning year after year, and you're having a high turnover rate for your teachers, that's also something that is evident by your budget. It usually takes at least $3,000 to onboard a new staff member between just the orientation, the subs that go into place while they're not in the classroom. You spend quite a bit of money. And anyone that really knows the dollars and cents for this industry can look at your budget and see that there's a problem there. Either they're going to think you have some really low ratios, or you just have a really high turnover rate because you're going to see it in the money. So having those financial statements and projections and getting an audit by a CPA is very important to start before you submit anything for a grant. Having a certified public accountant doesn't have to always cost you money. One of the places I used to get a lot of help was AARP. Retired people volunteer, and a lot of them sign up through AARP. And so we used to have a retired CPA come and take a look at our books. He didn't mind doing it though, because we had a software program in place, not just an Excel spreadsheet, that identified every cent of income, where it came from. We had grants that were government funded, such as the food program. We had grants for child care subsidies. We had all different types of grants, mini grants, matching grants from different corporations like Merrill Lynch. Like if their employee gave us $500, they would give us $500. So all of that was clearly identified, where if it was a matching grant program, it was there. If it was a grant for the playground, it was there. And then where we spent the money was identified easily. And so he didn't mind doing it for free, what he would normally charge someone $6,000 to do, because our financial reports were so easy to read. We also had a payroll service provider doing payroll. And so they gave us great reports that you could track all of our payroll expenses, and that's 65% of your budget if you're a high quality program. So those are just a few tips on making sure your record keeping system is in place financially, so that you're able to give someone documentation that shows you're a feasible organization to invest dollars in. Okay? Budget planning is important. If you're not doing this now, I highly encourage you to do it. But every year I would take a retreat around Christmas break. I would take 3 days. I would just go to the mountain somewhere alone. The first day I would just walk around, watch the birds chirp, swing in the swings, look at the trees sway. You know, if it was wintertime in some of the mountains, there was snow on the caps, watch the snow out of the windows, drink hot chocolate, just rest and get myself together, you know. The second day I jump into looking at those financial records and see if I could find any places where I could refine our budget, where I could refine our hiring practices as well as our parent and student recruitment practices and policies. Look at the calendar for the next year and do a budget plan for the next year. And then I'd submit that to the board. Now your board may not be requiring you to do that, but that's something that you should do, because you know what's necessary, or you will at least after this workshop. We're gonna talk about budgeting a little bit, but you know what's necessary to make sure that grant maker looks at your budget and sees that it's feasible. For instance, you should spend no more than about $1.52 per day per child on food. And we talked about the payroll. 50% typically tells someone that your program is mediocre. When you get up to about 60%, it's a better quality program, because we know your teachers are getting paid more than minimum wage. 60%, 65% means you have highly qualified teachers that may have credentials. So when we're looking at your financial report, those are just some of the indicators we're looking at. We're looking at what you spend in curriculum and material. Sometimes it's exorbitant for some of the programs. And then other times, even where you're buying the material from is not good. Like, I love Walmart, don't get me wrong, but I don't, some schools give their teachers like $20 to go to Walmart every week. Huh? Why not just take that? That's 50 weeks times $20 and go ahead and go to one of the companies that partners with ACSI, like school specialty, and then talk to them and negotiate with them. When I talk with their salespeople, I tell them, hey, I need you to bid and give me the best price you can because I could probably get this a little bit cheaper from this company and this a little bit cheaper from that company, but I want to work with you because you're a partner with ACSI. And those partnerships gain credibility for your program. When they see that you're only spending money with reputable companies like school specialty for your materials, then it's more likely they're going to partner with you. Some companies want, they have partnerships already with these companies. And you know, school specialty and ACSI have several partners. So try to stay within that network. If you're working with a salesperson, what they will do, if you give them your requisition list, they will go and find the lowest internet price, the last sell price they had. They will match those prices because they want your patronage. They want your business. So save the Walmart runs and just spend your money at reputable places, and you get more bang for your buck because you're going to build a reputation with their partners as you're doing that, okay? And most of the time you think that people don't pay attention to this, but they do. I've reviewed grants for organizations, and we do. We look at partnerships. Coca-Cola gives out a lot of grants over in Georgia, and they're looking at strategic partnerships. They want to invest in programs that are investing in people that invest in them. So you want to make sure that you're doing that. You do need an IRS determination letter for some grants that says you're a 501c3 organization. Others, you do not. You can just be a part of a church because most churches are recognized as nonprofit organizations. However, don't make the assumption that you are. You have to be registered with your state typically. So you want to check that and make sure that you can check that off of your to-do box that we are registered with the state. You want to have an active board and even a parent advisory committee. All of these things give you more credibility because it speaks to the quality of your program. It says that there are stakeholders involved in making decisions and making sure that best practices are being implemented. You want to make sure you go back to those community affiliations. Make sure that if there are businesses in your community and you're serving their employees, that you are connecting with them for funding. Step two is finding a grant that matches your vision. Where do you find grants? Okay, I'm going to take you on a little grant search in just a moment. One of my favorite places is the Foundation Center. They have locations all over the United States. How many people have ever used their database, their directory? Anyone? I see one hand there. Anyone else? Two? Yeah. Great resource. They have an online directory where you can search for grants that are offered by individuals or foundations or corporations that have foundations. The internet is a great resource. I've provided lots of websites on page 3 for you. I mean, there are just hundreds of them. I would really encourage you to spend most of your time, though, on the Foundation Center's website, and you'll see why in a moment. Most education publications will have grants in them as well. Corporations local and national that are in your community that you're going in and asking for a gift card, they usually have grants that they will give. So I'm not saying don't go ask for the gift card to shop, but also you might want to say, you know, how can we best be considered for a grant for our community? Talk with the managers that you actually see day in and day out or week in and week out. Professional associations offer grants as well. The Department of Education has several grants. I know that ACSI just recently had a webinar about the Title II grants, which provide funding for your teachers for professional development. Title I is also a really great one. It's the one that actually provides dollars for the 3 to 5 year olds to receive special needs services at your school. For every child in your program that is performing below their developmental level, there are tax dollars set aside to meet their needs. So they will provide materials as well as teacher training for teachers that serve those students. And so that is a different workshop, but ACSI is always having webinars on Title I and Title II. because there's a lot of funding. So for instance, if we had a four-year-old in our four-year-old classroom and they needed speech therapy, they would send a therapist to our program. But they'd also, once a year, have workshops that our teachers could go to, and they would pay for our substitute, as well as pay the salary of the teacher going to the training, her registration. Often it would pay for materials to bring back to the classroom to use with that particular child because they had a developmental delay in their speech. So there's a lot of funding through the Department of Education. A lot of your schools are going to have different experiences with them. The best thing to do is use ACSI's legal office to help you if you run into problems with getting services or funding for your school, because I've offered this workshop or similar ones, and directors have said, well, they wouldn't send someone to our school to do speech therapy, or they wouldn't provide, you know, materials for a student. And those tax dollars are your tax dollars. And so ACSI already has a lot of the materials prepared that you would need to maybe submit to the local school board or the Department of Education in your state to get resources and services. You're just going to have to be an advocate to get those dollars sometimes. But there are grant books and catalogs, and this workshop is actually based on one. The title of it is I'll Grant You That. And that book has a CD in the back with actual grants that were awarded. And I do have it listed, I think, on the last page of your handout. But there are several different grant books out there, and most of them do have samples in them. Your friends and family, if you ask them about the places they work, most places do offer some type of grant program. So grants are right under your nose. I was looking on the websites, and I found that the California Association for the Education of Young Children has a grant here. I know Walmart and Target both have what are called mini grants. They're about $4,000, and they mainly focus on literacy initiatives. So if you wanted to buy books for a new library, bookshelves, we did one from Target, and we bought the shelves that have visuals for story time. They had these little shoe boxes. So if you were reading the little book, The Little Engine That Could, the shoebox would have all these little engines in it, and while you're reading the story, the kids could pretend to play with their engines. And so it had 24 of those little shoeboxes and 24 big books that went with it. I think the thing cost about $800. We couldn't afford that, but we got a grant from Target to get it. Along with it, we bought the big $700 carpet with the phonic sounds on it. And what else did the teacher get for that one? A reading specialist that came to our school and talked to parents about, we paid her out of that and for refreshments. We had a reading night where the kids were able to read to their parents, and the parents were able to come and hear from the specialist on what to do. And so that came from Target. It was a $4,000 mini grant. Believe it or not, completing that mini grant, if you have the other documentation in place, like your business plan with a budget in it, took us about 20 minutes. It's like a credit card application. What's your tax ID number, your name, your address? You know, what do you want to purchase? We had the purchase requisition. Why do you need this? We already had like meetings with parents that said we wanted to focus on increasing literacy. We had the research there that said that we should, you know, because of the reading scores of the kids in the schools. And so everything was already there. It took about 30 minutes to write that mini grant. And there are a lot of them that are that way. The Walmart one is just as simple. As a matter of fact, it's online. And I kid you not, it's just like doing a little mini credit card application. Penny's, AT&T, Bell South, Quality Care for Children, United Way has a lot of grants as well. So there's lots of funding right under your nose. I went on to the Department of Education's website here, and there are many grant funding opportunities here. The California Department of Education provides one at this website, and you can get this PowerPoint later. But there's also usually funding available here in California for accreditation, facilitation, like if you need technical assistance with that, if you need quality improvement, like let's say your playground does need some repair, there's funding for that. The pre-K program, I don't know about here, but in Georgia, we cannot have it in a faith-based program, but there are churches that have them as an evangelistic tool. But they don't do any teaching, Bible teaching in them. And so you may want to do that if that's what the Lord leads you to do. I used to have a real big problem with that, but one day I was reading through the book of, what book is it in, where Nehemiah goes to the king and the king gives him resources to go and rebuild the walls around Jerusalem. And I was just so convicted because I was like, well, you know, I guess the government could give us funding to do some things, you know, and give us stipulations, because they did have a few stipulations they had to abide by. But I think in covenant schools, if you have to change anything about the nature of your teaching or your program, you don't want to apply for those types of funds that require you not to bless the food, not to pray for the kids, read the Bible, et cetera, et cetera. The food and nutrition program reimburses you for food expenses and the cost of food service personnel, and it doesn't require any, right now it doesn't require you to change anything about your program. You don't have to agree to, you know, not discriminate for sexual orientation or things like that in that application. That one you have to, there is a usually an anti-discrimination clause, but it only says sex, race, and not even religion, sex, race, and gender, maybe. So here are some more of those websites. I believe those are on your handout. Before you apply, you always want to read the grant, understand the funder, and make sure that your values are aligned. You want to visit the Foundation Center's website, find other material and investigate and just kind of research your funder. I'm going to take a moment and go to the internet and take a look at the Foundation Center's website. Let's see if we can do a quick investigation now of some funders. Let's see. Oh, it's going to require me to reduce all of this. Okay. I do have a subscription on the Foundation Center's website. And so when I go to their website, I can actually just search grant makers or companies that have received grants. And so the way I would do that, for instance, if I were looking for funding for an early ed program, can you guys see that, or do I need to make it a little bit larger? Okay. Now let's see if it's going to let me go to the side of the page. That's the only challenge when I do that. I shouldn't need to go over there. But here I'm going to look at the fields of interest. An index opens up over here. And I want to find a grant maker that's interested in giving to early ed. So I'm going to go up here to the E, and I'm going to click on early childhood education. And then I'm going to see what kind of support do we need for this program. Earlier, we were talking about buildings. Someone said they needed a building, so I'm going to click on that. Faculty and staff development is here. Let's say we just need general support to pay our mortgage. I'm going to click on that as well. There's leadership and professional development. I can click on quite a few of those. The playground would probably come under equipment. So let me go back up there. I'm going to click there. Okay, what transaction type? I think I'm going to just, I can leave that open to all, but you could ask for in-kind gifts. You could ask for loans. We don't want those. Use of facilities, if you did need to do that. Cash grants, there's 130. It tells you in parentheses how many there are. But I'm just going to leave that open so everything will come up. And I'm going to change the geographic focus here to California, because I really want to know who's giving in California. So I'm going to click there. And I could even, you see, I can even identify what type of grant maker. Like, I could only want corporate foundations, but I'm just going to do a search, a general search, and see what comes up. Okay, so 46 organizations came up. The Packard Foundation is here, and there's that California Community Foundation I was talking about earlier that sometimes requires you to get matching funding. But let's see, I'm going to click on Packard Foundation. I don't know anything about them, so I want to do a quick search and see what they're like. Okay, so it gives you all of the information for that organization. Their tax returns are there, and they're helpful in telling me who they give money to. I can click on them and look at their tax returns. But I want to go down a little bit more first and look at the background. So if I'm looking at computers, it looks like they would definitely be someone that would be a good match, because information technology is their thing. If I'm trying to create global learners, it looks like they'd be interested in that. But then under limitations, I see it says no support for religious or political organizations. Yep, so we scratch them. However, sometimes you do want to, don't click away right away, because sometimes you will go down and it will say something like, okay, here it says all foundation employees are eligible to have their gifts to public charities, schools, colleges, and other 501c3 organizations matched by the foundation. So if you have a parent or a board member that works for them and they give you money, they will match it. So don't automatically go, well, they don't give to religious organizations, because they do. They have a matching gifts program. So if their employee gives you $10,000, they will match it. They do matching gifts. Yeah, because you're a 501c3 organization, not because you're a religious organization. And usually in your organization's articles of incorporation, it's going to say the purpose for our organization is not just religious, but it's educational, it's scientific. Anyway, yeah, she's already nodding her head, because if you've looked at your articles of incorporation, your purposes aren't just religious. They are wider than that. So you're going to have in your purpose statement a little bit more than that. So that's why I do keep looking down. Even if it says they won't give me a big grant just to do what I want, they do matching gifts. Let's see what else they do. Pro bono consulting services. So where this would come into place, even if they say they don't do grants for religious organizations, with this particular one, let's say I did want to establish a computer lab, and I wanted to use that computer lab on the weekends for senior computer classes. That has nothing to do with teaching them about Christianity. I'm doing it as a Christian service to the community, right? And I'm doing it on the weekend when my little kids aren't there. But I need the computers, I need to pay the instructor. I would still write a proposal for this organization if it were me, because they're not asking me to change anything about that particular program I'm going to start. Does that make sense? They're not saying I can't share my faith in it. And actually, they would probably fund it, because you could do a program like that for maybe about $30,000 a year. So they would probably give you the funding for that. So you're still being a person of integrity, saying we are a faith-based organization, but this is an outreach we want to provide for the community. Now, could we use those computers during the week? As long as we disclose that we're going to use that computer lab during the week with our kids, yes. If they say we can, we can. Yes.
Quick question. I'm on the site now. But it won't let me go in because
you have to have a subscription.
Yeah.
Yes. You have to either have a monthly subscription or go into one of their offices and you can access their directory for free. Now, they have a basic search that you can do for free on their website, but to get all of the information I'm going to share with you today, you do have to have a subscription.
How much is a subscription?
It used to be about $20 a month, and I apologize. I don't know if it's still that much, but I usually write, how much is it?
23.
I usually write grants at least 3 or 4 times a year, so I just keep it on automatic, whatever. And I don't think I even pay monthly anymore. I think I pay annually, and it may be a few $100, like a couple of $100. But it's well worth it. If I'm going to write a grant, it saves me so much time. You see how I'm able to find out whether our values are aligned with that organization's values, like in a second? Yeah. Yeah, but also just really, even research the people. Something else I should have shown you too is when you go to their board, although they say they don't give to religious organizations, if you go back to that page, another thing I found is I was writing a grant for a school that was for special needs kids, and one of the kids' parents was related to someone on the board of an organization that had this on their site that said they wouldn't, and they did. They gave us the money. So if you notice here, it gives you the officers and trustees of their board of directors, and you want to look at those and even see if there are partnerships there. So see, for instance, Susan Packard is on, she's a trustee of the board of the Children's Hospital, Telosa Software, Monterey Bay Aquarium. And so if you have a parent or a board member that's also on the board with her at the aquarium, you can talk to them. And there may be something else they can do. Maybe they can't give you a grant, but they may have used computers in their offices that they're giving away to a nonprofit organization, and you making that connection gets you that. And so the sites are very helpful there as well, because they show you who the relationships are that they have in the community. What are their affiliations? So you see, they actually list the organizations they serve on. You see, two of them are on the board for the aquarium. John Hopkins School of Public Health, Bright Horizons Family Solutions founder and chair is Linda Mason, and she's on the board here. So that's very helpful information, okay? So that's one of the first things you want to do, is go to their site or one of the other sites and do your research. Read about the founder. Look at any application information that's required. I'm going to take you back to that site in a moment. We're going to do that. You want to check for a deadline, check for any pre-existing relationships. And then step three is completing the application or the request for the proposal. So you're always, if you're going to send in a grant, you're going to have a cover letter, and then you're also going to have a title page, and it's going to list these items here. Let me take you to my site and let you look at a sample. This was that technology grant that I recently had awarded. And I thought I had this page pulled up. Okay, you can go on my site at any time and look at this. It's pennconsulting.org. And so the sample grant is here. This is the cover page, and I just put the title that it's a assistive technology grant proposal, and this is for a special needs school. So this is the cover letter, and you are going to put it in business format. Their software, their letterhead just had a border on the side, so that's why you see it's indented 2 inches there. But I'm going to make this just a little bit bigger. And you'll notice I tried to do a few key things. In the very first paragraph, I tried to establish a credibility for the school by helping them recognize that it wasn't a new program, that it's been around for 12 years. Okay? And then I talked about its emphasis, its focus, and tried to clearly communicate their mission to serve children with exceptional needs. Now, unfortunately, only about, this was the experience entrepreneurial school, only 30% of their kids had special needs at this particular school. This is the sister to another one. If you notice, we kind of bulleted some of the things that were special about their school. Not only did they offer experiential multisensory learning, but they were developing kids for 21st century skill outcomes. And so we made sure we put that in there and explained that vocabulary to them. One of the reasons why I'm sharing this with you is because those are buzzwords today. Those are the things that people are kind of throwing money at to put the fires out, you know, because we have a workforce that is really unprepared. You know, we're finding people that are applying for the job online and then showing up to work and they can't read. And someone else did the online application for them. And so this is something that employers and big Fortune 500 companies are trying to avoid by investing in education, especially at the youngest levels. You'll notice some of the other things here. So those terms, critical thinking, problem solving, collaboration, communication, creativity, innovation, authentic real-world learning opportunities, all of those are kind of buzzwords that some of the grant makers are listening for. Including diverse learning styles, that's important. Serving that special needs property, special needs population is important too. If you notice, I identified some of the special needs that they do serve. And then I did have to go ahead and confess that only 30% of their students at this school had special needs. And so I tried to do it in a way where it still made it seem as if we really needed this money, okay? This grant was a hard one to get approved because they are smack dab in one of the highest socioeconomic status communities more affluent communities in Atlanta. They're in that Alpharetta area, and I don't know if you guys know about it, but it's one of the richest areas in Georgia. And so the school is there. So I couldn't say, well, we're in the, you know, our students are economically disadvantaged. So you see, I had to make the need that we want to improve the workforce, and the way we're doing that is through these innovative teaching and learning styles or ways or strategies, right? And so that's what you want to do. When you're completing the application on your handout, you'll notice on page 3 it lists the parts of the grant. And then you want to make sure that you, after you've read the requirements, you've included all those parts, that you follow the instructions completely. Check your spelling, your grammar. Have 2 or 3 people proofread it. So basically what you have to do that is, if the deadline is May 31st, which there are a lot of grants that are due May 31st, then you want to try and finish the grant May 1st. And have one person review it for the financial numbers, and at the same time have someone else review it for the grammar, okay? And then you want to have one last person go back through and check and make sure you stuck to the page limits. If they said, you know, don't hole punch it, don't hole punch it. If they said put a clip on it, put a clip on it. If they didn't say put a clip on it, don't put a clip on it. If they said wrap it with a rubber band, wrap it with a rubber band. Whatever they ask for, do it. Because I've actually turned in grants like at the last hour and been there to watch them as they went through the stack, and all the ones that had clips that weren't supposed to have clips, they just put them in the garbage. All that work. And a lot of the grants, you have to submit multiple copies. So I'm not talking about like a little stack of 30 sheets of paper. I'm talking about 8 stacks for 8 different reviewers to look at, just going straight into the garbage because they had a rubber band around them instead of a staple or whatever the requirement was. So make sure you stick to their requirements and that you do meet the deadline. Because I've also been there at the last minute to see people get turned away that wanted to submit a deadline because it was too late. And so those were the components we were looking at: the organization information, your form of evaluation. That budget is so important. You have to make sure your dollars and cents are balanced to the penny. A key to writing good objectives, really define the specific nature of your program. Who's it for? And then when you're talking about curriculum and teaching and learning strategies, don't use jargon and just assume they know what you're talking about. Spell it out. If you're talking about something being DAP, say it's developmentally appropriate practice because XYZ. You know, infants learn through their senses and their interaction with the environment and their caregivers, so it's developmentally appropriate for us to do this, this, and this for them. You know, really explain it. Okay, why are we providing this? And then describe how you're going to meet a need. What are the expected outcomes? Make sure they're measurable. And then make sure you have a realistic staffing needs assessment. That's one of the things I think Christian schools do really well, is that we do meet accreditation staffing guidelines, and they are superior to the state guidelines, but we forget to kind of brag about that a little bit, that we have ratios that exceed the minimal state requirements, which provides a higher level of care, quality of care for the children. And so you want to make sure you point that out. We kind of alluded to these SMARTER objectives earlier today, so I'm not going to go into detail about them again, but you do want to make sure those objectives are specific, they are measurable, tell how many, how much, how well the students will be able to perform something, or your teachers will be able to perform something. Make it audacious, something that no one else is doing. It's like, just stretches your imagination. It exceeds the horizons. And then make sure you are results oriented. You are identifying those results. Have a targeted timetable of when you're going to achieve certain things, and then make sure it's encompassing. It's not just going to impact your school, but your community at large, the city, the state, the nation, and then globally. And then make sure all of those objectives are reviewed frequently. So I want to do an exercise with you and see if we can't write an executive summary or program abstract from what we've seen here. But how much time do we have? I think we have, yeah, a good little bit of time to play with this. So, do you guys want to do it at your tables, or do you want to do it as a group all together? I'm open to either. How many want to do it as a group all together? Okay. All right, so let's do that. We're going to go through this together. So our first goal is to identify a problem that we want to address.
There are snacks
too. Okay. Okay. All right, so let's identify a problem. What's a problem in society that we want our school to address? Okay, teacher salaries. I'm sorry?
Insufficiently trained staff.
So staff training, okay? So that's going to be our problem. So our population that needs this will be teachers that are already working, but they're insufficiently trained. So where would we go find data to support this need that says there's a need for this? Anyone? Department of Education. So that's a great start. The National Center for Education Statistics it's a website on the Department of Education's website actually. So it's nces.gov, I believe. We could go there and find out how many teachers have credentials in the United States, how many are leaving, what the turnover rate is. We could do that. We could also use like Google Scholar. If you're in school and having to write papers, you're having to use libraries. Anyone, how many of you are in school now having to write research papers? Just a few? No, not many, just a few, yeah. Yeah, you could use your library, and so we have Galileo, we have quite a few different resources like that, and look for journal articles that are peer reviewed, that have research in them that says that we do have high turnover rates and it's because teachers don't feel equipped to do the job. They don't have the knowledge and skills to do the job. So we would have to state that need. And so we can't just say we need more training. We've got to say there's this need for it. And then even maybe do a focus group with our staff. Maybe give them a survey to complete that says, you know, do you feel you need additional training in this area? Now you wouldn't ask them, do you feel capable to do your job? Because most of them are not gonna say, no, I don't. But you wanna be very specific and maybe give them a questionnaire that says, would you like additional training in classroom management? Would you like additional training in child development? Would you like additional training in curriculum? Would you like additional training in health and safety? Or would you like additional training in using technology in the classroom? Okay, and then identify and specify. You see how I'm trying to make the objective very specific? So once we get the questionnaire from them in our proposal for our problem, we say 25% of our teachers feel inadequately trained to integrate technology in the classroom or to meet the developmental needs of children in today's classroom. And then that may require me to go do some more research. The census report, as well as the Department of Health for your community, will have sites where they tell you about the number of children that were born prematurely or with low birth rates. And so those are a couple of the places where I go first to determine the need. To say, you know, 17 to 40% of children in our state are born prematurely, which leads to developmental delays and XYZ. And so a lot of that is right there on the CDC's website. And it's already written, bless you, in a format that you can use in your grants. Some of you are looking like, I don't know how to find that. Do you want me to go take a look at it and let you see how to look at some of that even?
Yes.
Okay. I think we have enough time. So I'm just gonna go back to the cdc.gov site because even their articles will tell you at the bottom where they get their data from, and you do need to put all of that into your grant to support your thesis or your statement of need. Okay. So we're just gonna go to cdc.gov. Oops. Okay, and so I am going to type up here in the search window, developmental delay. And I'm just gonna click right here on facts, developmental disabilities. I'm gonna make it a little bit larger so we can all read it. Okay, it explains what it is, that developmental disabilities are a group of conditions due to an impairment in physical learning, language, or behavioral areas. These conditions begin during the developmental period, and they may impact day-to-day functioning and usually last through a person's lifetime. It should go on down to somewhere where they share like 1 in 6 children in the United States. At least 25% have hearing loss. So yeah, that's a great statistic, but they also go on and, there it is. Yep, does everyone see that where it says that 1 in 6 are about 15%? So that's a great statistic to have. And if you notice, I didn't point it out earlier, but right here is a footnote, our end note right there, that one is telling you that if you go down here, you can find where they got that data from. And so usually if you just highlight, this is from 1989. You really only want to use research that's within the last 5 years. So I'm probably going to do the other one. But you highlight and then you right click. And if you notice right there, it says search Google for that article, and it'll bring that article up. But I'm going to look for this one. It says trends in the prevalence of developmental disabilities in U.S. children, 1997 to 2008. And let's see what happens when we Google that one. So it does open up key findings. Let's see. I was trying to see if there was even a later date for the research. Okay, study finds increase in developmental disabilities in the United States. And we could even do a search for California. If I were writing a grant for California, I might just put, instead of in the US, I would put California children and see what comes up. And this is the exact type of data that you need to put in your grant in order to, I know I actually, I mistyped it. Yeah, they figured it out. Or actually, I think I was highlighting, trying to take out the word in, and I took out the N without the I. Here's a 2015 study that refers back to that 2007. So that's the data that we would include in our grant application. Here's one here. Researchers found that babies born in California, what was that saying? You see the wealth of information that's here. It says intellectual disability affects 1.4 million children in the nation. And then it had the report here for California. Let's see, is it? I was trying to find exactly where it mentioned California. Did anyone see it yet? If it was in the search. I wonder if that's one of the titles of one of the studies at the end.
Oh, there's California. Right underneath the.
I see it now. The researchers found that babies born in areas of California where tap water was contaminated had a 50% chance of having a poorly performing thyroid gland. Yeah. So it just shows that there's some environmental concerns. You could even talk about that in your grant application. Yes. I'm sorry. I can't hear. Thank you. Yes. As long as it provides foundational information to support your claims, yes. So there may be a study from 1960 or 1980 that may be relevant to what's happening even today. Yes, you can. You can. Okay, so we've said our problem was that we needed additional funding for teacher training. And so we want to go back and talk about how the kids have specific needs that weren't necessarily a problem before, maybe the disabilities. So our teachers need more training to address those needs. So the solution would be training specifically in dealing with children that have developmental disabilities or delays or disorders even. Maybe we might want to partner with Biola or Vanguard to have that class. The professor was talking about on special needs, have it maybe at our school, or have it where our teachers are able to take that class for free, so we're asking for scholarship funding for that. Or those four classes I think she may have mentioned, right? So that may be our solution. I think training should be reflective. So how do we follow up after the training? Because grant makers like to see that, where it's not just a one-day training that your teachers went to, but there's some way where they're continually being evaluated on their practicing what they learned. So maybe we could add that strand to our performance appraisal that we use each year and include that document. Maybe we could have a Skyping session with the professor to maybe talk about any challenges they had. Anyone else have any ideas on how we could measure improvement and how we could kind of follow up with the initial training to make this grant more attractive?
What about just how many more children that they were able to service because of the fact that they got this training?
Absolutely, how many additional children we were able to service and retain in our program. Maybe we didn't have to, we could even cite that statistic which is in the National Center for Education Statistics data that says more children are expelled from preschool than high school, and usually that's why, for behavior problems that we feel ill-equipped to address. So, yes?
And then you could possibly do, like, how long the staff stays.
How long?
They're educated more, and they're doing a better job, and they're more confident, and they're staying with the student.
Absolutely. I love that idea. She said we could maybe track how long the teachers are staying because their confidence levels have gone up or their competence levels have gone up. And so what you're even asking for is funding to do a longitudinal study that may require them to give you additional funding every year to follow up with that. And they like that. They like being able to track the effectiveness of their money so they can say, we did this, you know, we helped this happen for your children, you know. So great idea. So then the amount of funding requested would be what? What would we be asking for? The tuition for the classes, right? The equipment maybe that they might need, maybe books for the teachers, as well as maybe, I know here that there is a new profile that they're using to measure child development. What is it, the desired results? Now, I know we're going to use mostly faith-based programs material, but sometimes when you want to attract more dollars, you can incorporate something like that, which is not, you know, it's not hindering anything we teach. It's not contrary to anything we teach. It's the minimal things that kids should know, understand, and be able to do. And so something like that is an instrument that they feel is more reliable for measuring because it's secular. And so we can say we do this, but then we also do this instrument as well because it's state, promoted by our Department of Education in California. So that's what you want to do. It gives you more credibility for what you're going to do with those dollars. I think it can be administered, like it's a checklist or something that you do 2 or 3 times a year. Has anyone used it before?
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So how often do you have to administer it, or how often do you get to?
Well, if you're accredited, it's when your thingy expires. However long, it depends on how long your accreditation, your certification, thank you, is.
Okay, I was thinking for the children, that's what I was saying, every year? Twice a year, I was thinking at least 2 times a year because you need to know where the child is in order to monitor their progress to where they are. So at least 2 times a year. But something like that would be great to add to say our teachers were able to take the children from here to here, or 50% of the students were able to master this in a year, whereas before we didn't have that many. Okay? It's the California Desired. It's on the Department of Education's website.
Desired Results Development Profile.
Desired Results Development Profile. I have to keep up with so many of them. And there are so many out there, and usually your curriculum will have checklists as well, but they aren't nationally validated or you know, their reliability has not been tested to the same extent sometimes. And so that would be helpful with the California one. Then you want to talk about your organization and your program abstract. The name of your organization, the history of your program, the purpose, and its activities. And that would be just one paragraph, kind of like I showed you in the example grant application. Okay? Yes, did I see a hand up with a question? No? The websites that I provided earlier for statistics are there on your handout on page 4, the National Center for the Education Statistics, the National Institute for Early Education, U.S. Census Quick Facts, and the United States Department of Education. Grant makers are looking for innovative programs. They're looking for programs that have goals to improve student achievement or child development. And so if you just say, our mission or our goal is to do that, they're looking for those types of programs. If you are having any type of creative approaches to learning and teaching, grant makers are looking for that, especially technology. They are really, especially like places like the Apple products or Microsoft, they're all looking to put their materials in your classroom. And so you just have to write a really good grant for that. Professional development, making sure that teachers have the skills necessary to deal with job stress, making sure they have the capabilities to be effective as teachers. They're giving money to that. Yes?
I just have a question in general about the grants. How many grants do you write for each one that's funded in general?
I'm going to say about 75% of mine are funded.
Okay. That is cool.
Yeah.
You're really good.
How about the average person?
Actually, listen, it was this way before because our program was so desperate for funding. It was like if we didn't get a grant, I was going to have to close the doors. And so what I'm sharing with you is what I learned through blood, sweat, and tears to do for our school. And I would literally, the Foundation Center actually has an office in Atlanta. And when you go to their locations, you can access the material for free, but you can also take free workshops. And so I would go, and I would even go to the workshops and ask the people teaching the workshops to look at my grant. And I go, does this look okay, you know, and get feedback from them. And so, yeah, even then, it got to the place where organizations would call and say, Althea, we noticed you didn't submit a grant this season. Are you bringing one in? Or do you want to just fax us? They would literally just tell me, if you just fax me a new purchase requisition and a new minutes from where you met with your meeting to state your parents to state this was a need, we will give you the funds. If you just send it to us, we'll just put last year's application with this. Because it got to the place where I was begging for money from everybody. They knew who I was. They were like, we haven't received a grant from that little lady with that school down. Yes.
If you, because I'm assuming if you did whatever project you're trying to get funded on a smaller scale, like if you did a pilot version of it first, uh-huh. I'm assuming that would help your chances, but where would you kind of put that in with this format? Is that going to go in your problem and solution section of it, or would that be something you put separate?
Now, typically, this goes back to leadership where you have to have a business plan. You're in your business plan. She was talking about how do you start with smaller amounts and then maybe have graduated things. In your business plan that you should have for your school, you should have maybe phases. Like this year, we're doing this initiative, and then in 2 years, we're going to do this. And then if you're asking for funding, you just kind of cut and paste from your business plan. That this is our school's overreaching, overarching goal to do this, you know, create this many high school graduates or whatever. But this year we're focusing on doing this, and next year we're this. And some grant makers will fund it that way. Others will say, well, why not let us fund this part, and we'll get our partner organization to fund that part. So we'll fund the curriculum upgrades, and then we'll get our partner to fund your staff salaries or your staff training. So it's just about writing a really good, solid, strategic plan that a grant maker will be compelled to fund. And really, that's what your vision statement should be. It should be a statement that people, when they read it, like Habakkuk says, they want to run with it. They want to embrace your vision, bless you, and run with it. And so it all starts there with a vision statement, mission statement, business plan, or strategic plan. And you know, just like I found the Foundation Center and they started helping me draft those things for our organization, there are local organizations that offer free classes. The SBA offers free business plan writing workshops at libraries probably all around the state. I know it's like, where do we find the time to do that? You just have to make the time. And 2001 made it a priority for us, because the day after 9/11 happened, we lost 12 students that very next day, because so many of our employees were either working for government agencies or organizations that were no longer in existence or whatever, or their parents were being transferred. 12 students was like a huge chunk of our budget.
Yeah.
And I'd already hired the teachers, everybody's working, everything's, and we didn't have a plan B. So, I mean, I was desperate. I was already writing grants and getting little grants here and there, and we had a whole lot of our parents, and you probably have this too, the parents that are attracted to Christian schools, a lot of them are in technology. And so we had a whole bunch of parents from AT&T, and we used to write AT&T and Bell South mini grants every year. They had one for $4,000 or $5,000, and so those were annual grants. But when 2001 happened with 9/11, grant writing became serious because I had to find that money or either let the teachers go. So to answer your question, if I take the time to write a grant, I really want it to be, you know, rewarded or awarded, so I'm going to make sure that it meets the guidelines. And it's actually what we're talking about now. It's aligned with what the grant maker wants to do with their dollars. Evidence-based interventions. I know a lot of our curriculum says that it's evidence-proven. It's research-based, I'm sorry. But we want to make sure that what we're using, the practices as well as the curriculum, it can be broadly replicated in different populations, but it's most effective with our students, and we can show that with numbers. So really investigate what you're using, and if it's not research-based, maybe write a grant to get something research-based, because a lot of people don't want to put their money out there just to experiment. The SBA actually reports that for every early childhood program that opens this year, 50% of them will not be in operation in 1 year. For everyone that opens this year, 90% of them will not be in existence in 5 years. Do you know why? Everything rises and falls on a lack of leadership capability and management of the program. And so it's really important that when we are implementing things, they're just not ideas out of the sky. We're looking at what's research proven to work, and then we're implementing that best practices. Rigorous work, get together a lot of people with different ideas and different philosophies, because you need that feedback from them before you send the grant off to someone else that's going to look at it with those perspectives. So that's what I was kind of alluding to earlier, where I'd have someone from a financial background look at the grant. I'd have someone from an educational background look at the grant. I'd have someone from an HR perspective look at the grant. And you don't have to go find people and pay them. They're in your schools. We had like three or four teachers or parents or family members that had degrees in HR, human resources management. So when it came to writing grants about professional development, they could really help me tweak the wording a little bit better, because my degree's not in HR, it's not in human resources management. But they could talk to me a little bit about organizational behavior and how the dynamics of the follower and the leader, their relationship, how they work together, and how best to improve that. So I had to pull, you know, just a lot of different people in to help me. And sometimes I'd have them just come in and eat lunch with me at the school, and we'd have a meeting and go through the grant. Closing achievement gaps and preventing dropouts. Those achievement gaps have been around for years, and if you can tackle that problem, you can address closing the achievement gap. That is huge. People are really trying to figure out, well, what do we do? Well, I always tell people in grants that any type of character education without the Bible as a foundation is futile. And so that's where some of that achievement gap begins, is with the children learning academic content apart from the social emotional development. That connection, that disconnect is not there, or the disconnect is there. And so I usually will talk about the faith-based component being that missing part, and that kind of attracts some funders. The benefits of high quality childcare programs are talked about in this study by Pre-K Now. It's on their website. It says that if you have a high quality child care program, that you're going to produce successful students that grow up to be responsible adults and strengthen the community. Those are three things that you want to mention in your grant application that are outcomes. They even talk about the number of dollars that are saved in our juvenile delinquency as well as our rest of our judicial system by students having a quality, high quality preschool experience. And so they say it increases high school graduation rates, improves standardized test scores, decreases grade retention rates and special ed placements. It reduces juvenile delinquency and teen pregnancy rates, and it saves taxpayers $7 for every dollar invested. And so those are the types of statements that you want to include in your proposal that will get you the dollars. Now, typically, I want to give you some time. Some of you, how many of you brought a wish list with you? Some items that you wanted to purchase. Only one person brought a catalog. Okay, two, three. Okay. Yeah, I want to give you some time to kind of share your vision statement and your mission statement. And let's just actually, if you have a vision statement, tell us what it is and let's see if it's measurable. And then one of your goals for what you want to do with funding, tell us that and we'll see if we can give you some feedback, see if that's measurable as well. So anyone want to share with us their vision or mission statement? They're two different things, but yes.
Our mission statement
okay.
is on the back of our card.
Okay.
It says Covenant Christian School's God-given mission is to provide a solid biblical and academic foundation on which each child can build for the future. So pretty big.
Okay. Yeah.
When you said this at the beginning of the seminar, I wonder who wrote this.
Yeah. So how do we measure that we've given the kids a solid foundation that they can build on later? So that sounds more like your mission statement.
Yes.
The vision would be
that's what it says.
The kids would need, we would employ holistic teaching and learning strategies in order to enhance early childhood development and later school success, something like that. Because you can measure holistic development. Just like you can measure physical development, you can measure social development by the children learning to use their words by the time they come out of the two-year-old classroom instead of biting and da-da-da. You know, you can have those student outcomes. You kind of, you see that? And then,
can you say that again, what you just said?
I don't know what I just said. But you see how I use some really key words for teaching the whole child, because I understand what she meant by having a solid foundation.
We would employ holistic teaching and learning
strategies. Something like that, yeah. All right, anyone else have one you want us to test out and see if we can kind of make it a little bit more measurable? Yes. Okay, and what age group, what grade level do you stop at?
5-year-old, or what's pre-K? From 2 to 3K.
Okay, so what we have there is a mission statement that is a great mission statement, but it's not really measurable for your age group because we won't be able to know if they go into the world as missionaries until they're 18, unless you're going to do some type of experiential learning components in what you're doing now. Let's say you take your kids to nursing homes to minister, or you have them do fine arts presentations and they are supposed to be a ministry outreach for your preschool. But otherwise, how can we measure that a 5-year-old is going forth into the world as a missionary? So you see how that kind of relates more to like a high school program, and you would kind of report the percentage of your students that are interested in ministry, maybe have identified their spiritual gifts and are already employing those in high school and they're preparing themselves to go out, whether it's to college or into the workplace, as missionaries. That's what that mission statement sounds like. You guys get what we're talking about? Yeah, so if I were to receive a grant application with that, I go, I don't know. Is that what I want to do, send five-year-olds out as missionaries? Because I could just, which our church, by the way, does that, but they do it. We do family missions trips where, like we have a missions base in Guatemala where we have a hotel that they turned into like a feeding center and place to serve the children there. They teach them during the day and everything. Well, you can take your whole family there to serve for a week. And they do 1 week mission trips. So you can take, I think the youngest child is like a 2-year-old that can go with you. But realistically, how much ministry is the 5-year-old doing, you know? They probably are singing a song, but they really don't get it at five. You know, we did things like that at our school too, the nursing home and things like that, but they really don't fully understand what they're doing or what the full view of that is until later, maybe second, third grade, maybe. Mm-hmm. But that's still a spiritual foundation for it. And then you still have to identify your outcomes. Now, ACSI has some great ones and some of the tools that they have for student outcomes for faith development. And I would definitely use those in my literature. Right now, I want a playground for my babies. So I don't know. I might go back to that holistic development thing where I need to focus on their physical development if I want a playground. You know what I'm saying? That needs to be connected and aligned with the purposes for my dollars. Okay? Anyone else have another one?
The vision really can be specific toward that need. It doesn't have to be an overarching vision.
No.
Or can it change according to what need you're looking at?
No, you want your problem, and that's a really great question. You asked, does the vision have to be overarching? Your vision does need to cast vision for what your school is going to do. Give everyone a big picture view of what you're trying to accomplish. And then your mission needs to kind of identify some of the specific objectives that you want to do. In your grant, that needs to be aligned with what you're asking for money for, you know? There are some dollars that are out there. If you notice on the list of organizations I think I have in your handout, on page 8, the S.D. Betchel Jr. Foundation, I haven't looked at that closely, but that may be a Christian that passed and left all their money to Christian education programs. He would give money to that organization that's going to send the 5-year-olds out as missionaries, because he's not really concerned about their whole child development. He's just leaving money to Christian education programs, right? But most of these others, ExxonMobil, George Lucas, Caterpillar, Johnson & Johnson, we're gonna have to appeal to them that we're developing the whole child, not just spiritually, but socially, emotionally, physically, and cognitively. Bless you. So to answer your question, you need to have a solid vision and mission statement that's very clear about who you are and what you want to accomplish in the world. And then from that, you want to have initiatives that you're getting funded that are aligned with that vision and mission statement. Okay? So we just can't talk, because for spiritual development, really all you need is a Bible and the Holy Spirit. You don't need my money for the playground. You know what I mean? But if you want the money for the playground too, then tell me that you're developing the whole child, not that you're neglecting the spiritual side, the faith development component. Definitely that's not what I'm going to tell you to do. But show me how you're going to be able to measure what you're doing with my dollars. And so I was talking about the ACSI student outcome list, because it does give you some measurables, things you should see even in the younger students for faith development. And that's also in that set that we were referring to in the last session, the purposeful action set. What is the title of the whole set? Let me get the name of it. And I'm sorry, I look at so many things. It's called Early Education Ministry Pack. That's the name of the entire set. It's 3 books, and one of them deals specifically with spiritual development. or faith development. And so it does have indicators that you can have, that you can measure that. So it's not saying that you can't measure it at all, but most people that are going to find your program, unless they're like this gentleman that may have left this as an endowment to Christian schools, they're going to be looking at a bigger picture. How can this impact the global community today? Okay? All right, so let's take a moment. We were talking about vision statements, mission statements, and just can we measure them? What are some other statements or parts of your proposals that you want to maybe let me hear now so we could see if we could measure that? If it's something you have a question about it being measured, yes.
Well, like the vision and mission statements.
Mm-hmm.
Ours is Barstow Christian School is committed to excellence in education and character formation from a distinctively non-denominational Christian perspective.
Okay. Read it again for me at the beginning. I'm sorry.
That's okay. Barstow Christian School is committed to excellence in education and character formation.
Okay. I love that. Excellence in education and character formation. You can measure both of those. How will we measure them? With a profile for the academic, and then the character education could be the ACSI components. So both of those are measurable. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's good. Okay. Anyone else have one? Yes. I like it, but explore, what were the other words?
Innovate and transform.
Now, I think if you're going to use that, you're just gonna have to do a lot of explanation, because I understand what you're saying. You're gonna help them go all the way up Bloom's taxonomy. See, I'm an educator, so I get it. But with the guy at Walmart that's reading your grant, get it? I get it. We're gonna go, we're gonna let them through discovery learning, go from just remembering a lot of facts to taking that knowledge and actually creating new information. And so we have tomorrow's engineers in our classroom, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so I think you can measure that to a certain degree, but it's going to just need some explanation that that's where the innovation is coming from, is that we are giving them the fundamental skills to build upon. Absolutely. So that would be a great mission statement for writing. I could see a grant like that that I would write for Lego products or anything that's open-ended. Yeah, anything that's open-ended, scientific, you know, materials that are open-ended for learning, because we want our kids to create and discover and explore and, you know, yeah, discovery learning products. Yes, definitely. Yes. Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Oh, I love that, but it's so long, and that's really a mission statement. Your vision statement, when I say it should be concise, it has to be, I think 20 words is long, 25 is too long too. Even the mission statement, you want it to be as concise as possible. I have a couple of examples. One for a vision statement is where lifetime learning begins. Where lifetime learning begins. That's a corporate, one of the franchises that used to be their mission state, vision statement. Where lifetime learning begins. And so it says volumes with what, how many words? Five words? Where lifetime learning begins, four words. It says volumes. It means we're actually going to be teaching even the infants to learn. They're gonna be learning. And we're gonna teach. Yeah. Okay. Begins. Yeah, and so it just takes more explanation. That's what I was thinking about. Even for the other one, it takes a little bit of explanation in your summary that our program uses hands-on discovery learning about science, nature, you know, people, groups, whatever else. You just have to identify those bullet points very well. Be very clear in how you identify those, but I think that's great, just looking at your vision statements. Yes?
Okay, mission statement. First question, preschool is
I love that. And I love that you could recite it without reading it to me. I used to give my teachers a $100 gift card for that. I did. I used to give my teachers a $100 gift card. If I could just walk up to them and they could recite our mission statement or vision statement, either one. Yeah. But I like that one because you did say some things that were measurable in there. Repeat it again because you said... Okay, so learning, exploring, and growing, we can measure growth. We can also measure safety. And so, you know, we talk about maybe 60% of injuries occur on the playground. Our playground incidents are, you know, null. We don't have any or whatever. Our students, our school one time was audited by the health department because our attendance rates were so high. And this was for our preschool. And they were like, it's just unheard of that your preschoolers are here all these days. And then our shot records were 100%, you know, all of everyone had their records. And up to date or whatever. So the nurse actually came just randomly one day and said, we're here to audit your school's attendance records and shot records. And I just thought, well, yeah, I was like, what are you talking about? And she said, well, it's just unheard of that for infants and toddlers, you don't have a lot of them absent. Your attendance records were like 90-something percent. And she was like, no, they are usually much lower than that. Well, our policy was your child have a contagious symptom, they're going home. And we enforced it. We weren't afraid to lose the tuition. And so that made parents more responsible. We had a doctor come out every September that did a presentation on nutrition. He talked about processed food and food coloring, and you know, he'd do all of these great demonstrations with the kid, with the teacher, the parents and teachers, and it made everyone make healthier choices, you know? So it was really interesting to get audited for having a high attendance rate, but we were able to in turn put that in grant applications later. So those are the type of things we don't think of as data that we can use, but you want to track that. Your staff absences as well. You want to track that as well because there's research and data out there that indicates that numbers are not that high in public education or secular preschool programs. Okay? So you do want to track as much of that as possible. All right, so one person asked, how often do you get awarded the grant money? I write so many grants now, it's like really I get more of them approved than turned down. I mean, so much more often than I thought of, but it's because I tried and failed. And when I do fail, I always call and ask why. I don't do just an email to the person. I will actually call and say, why were we not considered and where could we have, you know, done things a little bit differently on the grant application? And then the next year I apply to that same person again and do what they told me we didn't do before. Sometimes they will ask, who else are you asking for funding from? But they don't always. Now, if you would get two, she's asking if you write the same grant for two different places and they both award you the money, it would be unethical to keep that money and not tell them you got the money from the other company. But you really are probably going to have to choose one of them to keep the money and then the other, ask them if you could use it for something else. Oh yeah, you don't have to tell them that unless they ask. Yeah, she's asking now if they don't ask on the application, if you're submitting this to other people, do you have to disclose that? And no, you don't have to, but many of the grant applications will ask if you're asking for funding from other people. Because sometimes they will partner with the other organization and say, we'll do half if you do half, or we'll do this part of it and you do that part of it. That's what I was talking about earlier. Okay? All right. Why should I fund your vision? You want to make sure your executive summary answers that question. Who are you? Where are you? Where will your goals take you? What do you need to get there? And what makes you so special? Those are just the rubber meets the road questions that you want to be able to answer in your executive summary. Okay? these are a few of the applications that I thought were worth maybe even time looking at. Captain Planet has one for $2,500 right now. That's great for after-school programs. And I've written that one for several programs that have butterfly gardens or just raised bed gardens altogether. I also just recently had some plants given to us. We were talking about gardens, and some of the ladies over here are getting very excited. Bunny Farms provides cabbage plants to third graders. Well, if you have an after-school program, you can get those as well. So even if you don't have a full-day program for school-age kids at your school, your after-school program may qualify for some things like that. Remember to strategize when you are selecting applications. Think like the funder. With Captain Planet, we know they're all about the environment. And so that may be an organization that we would write grants that have to do with gardens, water systems. Maybe we want new water fountains, or we want water fountains installed in the classrooms. Those types of things are what they are willing to give to. Sprint would obviously invest in some of the technology things that you might need in the classroom. But think like the funder, and then teamwork pays off. Do meet with your parents and do a needs assessment. I used to always meet with my parents at least once a year and just say, what are some needs that you have that maybe we're not meeting, or some things that you'd like to see us integrate? Not the whole parent body, but about six or seven key families that served on our advisory committee. They really appreciate it, being able to have, quote unquote, our ear, the board's ear, my ear. And even if we never implemented anything that they suggested, just them being able to have that sit down time where we could go through and talk about the materials, the equipment, the procedures that we had in place. So that's really important, getting all stakeholders involved in the brainstorming process, and then being detail oriented. Be clear, brief. I mentioned earlier avoiding confusing acronyms and jargon. We know what a lot of those things mean, but other people don't. SIDS, all those different, there's so many different terms we use in early ed that other people wouldn't have a clue to. We want to make sure we explain that. And try not to wait until the last minute, and I can't reiterate enough, making sure you check eligibility, spelling, the numbers, grammar, the funder's assessment system. Most of them will have their rubric there that they're using to review the grants, and you want to take a look at that. Typing, copying requirements. If they ask you to submit 8 copies and you don't, they're not going to review your grant, because they're probably going to have those 8 copies sent to different reviewers. If they can't get 8 scores back, the grant's of no use to them. So if you send in 1 copy, they're not going to copy it. They're just going to file 13 it. So double check that as well. After you receive the grant, make sure you maintain great records, that you send thank you notes, nice pictures. You evaluate and share those results. Return that report to them in a timely fashion. If you've had the grant for a year and they give you 30 days to submit the grant after that year period, submit your grant within that 30-day period, okay? And then include pictures. Make sure that, I've mentioned that earlier, including nice pictures. Make sure that you really take a look at the background in the pictures. I do workshops like this all over the place in Georgia every weekend. And before I go out to do some workshops, I will visit their website and just kind of look at the school and get a feel for the teachers. I might even go to the inspection site for the state and see what their inspections look like. You would be amazed at the things I see. I talked about earlier, you know, the teacher creating a behavior problem where the bookshelves are just crammed with stuff. They look like a storage cabinet. Instead of them having just a few items, few key items, because we understand young children don't have the ability to look at all of that and make a decision, choose one item and pull it down. They have difficulty, they're overstimulated, right? I look at some of the pictures and I'm overstimulated by all the things on the wall. And then surely when I look at the wall and the artwork, I can tell that the teacher sat there and she put the glue on the item and she held the child's hand and they intentionally glued every piece into perfect place. I can tell by looking at that on the wall. So you don't want to do that. Don't want to send things like that in. I saw another picture where they took a picture, for a program that had funded a music program. And they had the music teacher there with her violin. It was part of the after-school program. She's standing there. The kids are all sitting on the floor. Their backpacks and lunch bags are not on the expensive cubby storage area. They're on the floor, right next to her standing there playing a violin. And the kids are on the floor. And I'm thinking, why aren't they in chairs? Those nice $50 chairs that are sitting there in this school, the kids are on the floor. So not those pictures. Those aren't nice, okay? Make sure you really, I wanted to go back to that because that's so important. Sometimes your pictures, they will publish on their sites. And you want to make sure it's something that you can be proud of. Make sure you spend the money only for what you requested it for. These are other internet resources, and I think I did put them on your handout. I was just trying to check. The Scholastic website has lots of funds. The book recommendations are there as well. And then be accountable. Evaluate. Make sure your program is viable. Look at ways you can improve your program. If you want to look at what grant reviewers are usually checking out, this is a great website on the National Institutes of Health. The grant reviewers typically have a rubric, as I mentioned earlier, and here they give you a few tips for applicants for grants from them that are standard for the industries. When it looks at what we're looking at as far as categories of spending and just the components of your grant, the scores that you typically get for each part of the grant application. Okay? I think I have a little bit of time. I want to show you one of the most profitable early education programs in Georgia is Sheltering Arms. And let's see. They have 12 centers in Georgia. During the height of the housing crisis, they were able to bring in $23 million. Let's see if this is, that's in Minnesota. I'm looking for Georgia. I'm sorry, I thought I had this open earlier. Let me go back up and put Georgia there and see if it will bring up exactly the one I'm looking for. But during the middle of the housing crisis, their one school year, they had $23 million in revenue come in. Only $3 million of their revenue came from parent tuition. The rest of it was from grants. I'm going to go find them through, oops, that's not going to help me. Oh, I'm trying to get the receiver, and it's taking me to the, let's go here. They have a full-time grant writer. She makes about $65,000 a year. Their program director, they pay her about $90,000 or more per year in most of their locations. And it's because they're able to increase their revenue streams. They're not dependent only on parent tuition. Now, they do have a lot of government-funded programs like Head Start. This is 2003. I'm going to pull up maybe their 2004 website, their 2004 tax return. And I just want to show you this, just to encourage you that there's money out there. This is 2004. In 2004, they had $19 million in grant funding and only $3,000 in revenue from, well, even that, those are government fees and program service from the parents. So these are $3 million from tuition and government fees and $19 million in grants in one school year. They have 12 centers. That's unbelievable, but what's even more amazing is that if you look at the other years, we can look at 2003, it's probably just as much or more. So the money's out there. This is the year they made $23 million in grants and $3 million in revenue from tuition. So there's no shortage of money. It's out there, and you can do this. Are there any questions about the steps or the proposal? Yes? It depends on the size of the grant. Ladies, she asked a really good question. She said, how much time? If you're writing maybe one of the $4,000 grant applications and you have a business plan with an audited budget, you can write one of the 4,000 ones in a day, a week, because you already have your business plan, which you're really just copying and pasting from it your vision and mission statement. And then the only thing you're adding to that is the requisition list and the kind of the strategy or solution that you're suggesting for whatever initiative you want funded. So that's what's going to be different, but it's supported by your business plan. If you have a really solid business plan or strategic plan in place that already has a budget, has a vision, mission statement, you're just constantly adding to it. Yes. That's a good question. It depends on the grant. Okay? Some of them, most of them that I usually apply for, some of the, let's say $50,000, $100,000 ones, their deadline's May 31st, and you have the funding and time to buy everything for the next school year. So that's like late June, early July. Some of them, the deadline may be May 31st, and you don't hear anything till later. It really depends on the organization. So on the Foundation Center's website, where we were looking at the Packard Foundation, down there, they will tell you the deadline for submission, and then they'll tell you when they review the applications. So for instance, they might say our board meets in March, June, October, and those are the dates we make the decisions. So usually they will let you know you've received the grant, you've been awarded by that funding, and they'll let you know then how soon you can expect the money. And it just depends on who you're getting the funding from. The technology grant that's on my website was a foundation that we were able to get that money like within 10 days. Yes?
You had mentioned, you know, some of the things that you need when you're giving the grant, like finances, and that they want to see that you're still going to be in business in 5 years.
Yes.
So probably startup schools would not be as liable to get a...
No, that's not a problem, because startup schools do get grant funding. She was asking, she said sometimes they want to see audited returns, so would that make a startup unlikely to get funding? No, it depends on the type of money you're trying to get. So an established school might be applying for operating support, whereas a startup may need seed money to get started and then continuing operation support. So it just depends on the viability and feasibility of your vision, your mission. Is it realistic? Is it something measurable? Are your objectives specific? Do you have the key people in positions to make it happen? Those are the things that matter. So if it's a new program, but you have highly qualified administrators and teachers that are starting the program, you can get even as much or more money than a program that's been in existence for years. Okay? It's just making sure your key members or, you know, have some level of competence in what they're doing and have a track record that you can prove. Maybe even including recommendation letters from parents, you know, other people in the community. Those credibility, those add to your support. Those are supporting documents. Yes?
So if, say, you're using the May 31st deadline, can you submit it ahead of deadline, or is it, and then they might approve it before the deadline even happens, or is that they have to wait till the deadline ends before they even review it?
Typically, they do have to wait till the deadline ends to look at applications, unless it's a rolling, you know, grant, and they'll tell you that then. But they may say when funds are gone, if it's a rolling grant, they're gone. And so that's what happens with us in Georgia. We have a salary supplementation program there for teachers, where every school you can send in your licensing information and sign something that says you don't discriminate. And then they give all of the teachers a certain amount. Like if you have a bachelor's degree or a master's, you get $2,000 a year just for working in a preschool that's licensed by the state. If you have just a TCC, it's like $400 a year. So that money is available as long as we have tax dollars there for it, but usually they run out by a certain time in the school year. So you could submit an application for that and your teachers not get it because they've just run out of tax dollars. Okay. So does that make sense? You guys understand? Any questions? Yes? There are lots of funds that are available to programs that are distinctly Christian. What you have to help them understand is that it's very difficult to provide high quality services when your only revenue stream is parent tuition. I was about to say teacher tuition. We pay tuition, but it's parent tuition. So you do want to increase revenue streams with as little effort as possible. And so there are many families out there. There are many Christians that have money that they're trying to, you know, invest in tomorrow's child or the future in. They want to invest in programs. I have a nephew that played professional sports, and he had a son with MS. And his signing bonus one year was $5 million. You know, I can't even imagine how much tax that was going to be. So he gave a huge portion of his signing bonus to a foundation for MS, for children with MS. And the main reason he did that was so that his, you know, his taxable amount would be lower. I'm sure he gave it too because he was concerned about the services and research that the kids were receiving. But part of that, he gave away such a huge amount of it, I think part of it was just to lower the tax liability. Yeah. So I don't know about everyone else. I'm sure other people find other tax shelters, but there are some people out there that are just good-hearted, and they're like, well, the government's doing an okay job, but not so good in this sphere, education specifically, especially, you know, faith-based. You know, now we've kicked God out of schools pretty much. And so there are people out there that have resources and they want to get it into your school. So I would just encourage them to make sure that their mission is aligned with the mission of those organizations. My nephew actually ended up starting his own foundation, and I think that's one of the reasons why he wanted to make sure those dollars were spent the right way with MS, research and services. So there are a lot of people that are not willing to start their own schools, but they will invest in yours. We had a young lady that was single that volunteered for us every year. I didn't talk about this a lot, but she worked for Honda. And Honda lets their employees take a week off to work for a nonprofit, and they pay them. And so she was a single member at our church, and she worked with me in children's ministry for years. And she would come every year and coordinate our summer program. She would design the program, interview staff, put the publicity out there. In 1 week, she'd do most of this. And she'd come back during the summer and just kind of check on the program. Well, after doing that for about 3 years, she really believed in our program. And you have these types of volunteers, too, that get to come in and see behind the scenes, and they fall in love with Christian education. And that's the way she was. She was single, didn't have any kids. Well, she actually went to work one day, came home in a hurry. It was raining. She slipped at the bottom step of her apartment. She slipped, like, running down the steps at her apartment and fell and broke her hip. Well, her apartment complex ended up settling with her for millions of dollars out of court. And we didn't even know anything about her settlement until we got an anonymous check from United Way about the same time that she was buying new cars, bought a house, and all this stuff. And we kind of put two and two together. And we finally went to her and said, thank you for the gift. And she said, how did you figure out that it was me, blah, blah, blah. And we told her, we said, well, we just noticed all the other changes in your life and everything. She, you know, been asking about investment advice and all this. You know, it was just really interesting. We put the thing together. But we said, why didn't you want us to know that it was you? And she said, well, I just didn't want everyone asking me for money when I knew if I ever had some money, I always said I was going to give it to your school. Isn't that cool?
It's really cool.
But there are people out there like that. And for her, it was easy to do it through United Way because she said, I was looking for where to put some money. I wanted to give your school some money. I was so relieved to find that you were on their database of nonprofits and that I could give through them. I just called them up and told them we offer parenting workshops, we do this. You know, I just offered them our services. And once we ended up on their database, we would get calls about grants, all different types of services. We just got in their database. We started with the parent workshops, I believe, where we offered our parenting seminars and we opened it up to the community. So I think that's how we initially got in there. But we would get free books from companies that just publish too many and they have boxes and cases. And they would just go to United Way and say, we have someone we're gonna give books to. And they would just give it to us, yeah. So I think they probably have a database on their website that you could just add your name to. We were on there too for volunteers. You know, we would ask if they had like a volunteer day for the city and we had special projects like painting or putting wood chips on the playground or whatever. So that's how we got in there. But yeah, they were one of those organizations that if they did have funding they found out about that would match something we did, they would contact us and say, do you need XYZ? We have it, you know. Yeah, great question. Because that's what I meant when I said United Way earlier, but I didn't think to go into detail because there's so much. When you partner with the community that you're in and not stay like kind of closed off, yes, we are in Noah's Ark, but we, you know, we want to serve the community. And so when you make those connections and let them know what your needs are, they will remember you. Yeah. Any other questions or comments? Please remember to do your evaluations. And if you'd like to get this handout, Susie said that it's going to be on the website available there, but you can also go here and download it. I think the handouts are there as well. And I may have, I think I put an actual grants guide there from one of the playground providers, and that might be helpful as well. Thank you for your time, and I really enjoyed being with you guys today, and I look forward to tomorrow. I pray that this has been helpful. Thank you.
Biola University prepares Christians to think biblically about everything, from science to business to education and the arts. Learn more at biola.edu.